Recording. Okay. Hello, everybody, and welcome to our fourth and final travel talk of the season. My name is Melissa Olson. I'm the director at the Alice L. Pendleton Library on beautiful, today anyway, Islesboro. I would like to introduce Mark and Nada, who we have known, my family has known since the girls were 10 years old, and we decided to do this series because, as we all know, none of us can travel right now, so I thought we could do it vicariously. I'm really excited in learning more about Istanbul, which my middle daughter, Olivia, has been to with Yasha. I'm not sure if I knew that trip or not. I didn't know when she was going to Israel. Pretty sure I knew about Istanbul. But anyway, I am going to turn it right over to Mark and Nada. It looks like everybody is muted. If you would like to ask a question, you can either do it in the chat and I will talk, I will let Mark and Nada know, or you can, you know, do this, or you can unmute yourself. Is that okay, Mark and Nada, if they ask questions that way?
Yeah, or if you want, you could just hold your question and then we'll just take a bunch of questions at the end if it's easier.
Okay, or we could do that.
Or what? Whatever. I mean,
we can okay.
Okay, this is doing something very weird. No, right. Wait. This is doing something extremely
it's
weird.
It's going by itself. It's no. on a, yes.
I know, but it's not obeying any of the commands. It's not obeying any commands. This thing has gone mad.
Well, it's not mad on our side, on our end.
No, but it's moving by itself, and we want to move
mouse.
It ourselves.
I also don't have a mouse.
What computer are you on?
Mark.
My computer. Okay.
That might be the problem.
Yeah,
because
how did it go?
It's gone mad. Hold on, patience.
It's technology. We'll be patient.
Because we don't even have a mouse.
I have.
No. I'm saying that it doesn't show up on the screen.
Oh.
Okay. Now. You don't see our screen now, do you?
No.
Right. So we're going to try this again with the screen share.
I think you got out of
here.
There you are.
Oh, there's Danny. Screen share, share.
Well,
so okay, now it's sharing.
Yeah.
Do you see this? Slides?
And, we do. All of them together.
Okay.
Who's this?
Yeah.
Oh, so now we're seeing your email. Okay. Yes, that looks good.
We still don't have...
Okay, now stop. Hold on. I'm trying to just...
Go back. Yeah.
Is it stopped?
Up and down. So it's up and down.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so... I'm going to talk first and go through part of our slide. We just divided it in half, and then I'll hand it over to Mark partway through. Okay, so we've basically had a 30-year love affair with Turkey, which began in 1992 when we went there on our honeymoon. And over the years, we brought groups of students to study there on travel abroad study programs. And then in 2016, we moved to Istanbul for 2 years and taught at MEF University. We taught architecture there at MEF University before retiring. So today we're going to, since we've traveled all over Turkey, but today we're just going to talk about Istanbul. And here you can see it vaguely with that little red dot marks the spot. Istanbul is a city of fluids. Below in this map, you can see the Sea of Marmara with the little dotting of islands are the princess islands. And the Bosphorus Strait is the vertical water shaft in the center, leading to the Black Sea at the very top of the image. And then the little squiggle, if we go down to the bottom of the Bosphorus where it meets the Marmara, that little squiggle on the left is the Golden Horn. Sorry, I don't have a cursor. I can't actually get on the slide with a cursor, so I'll have to do it this way. And it's a fresh, the Golden Horn is a fresh water river that empties out into the Bosphorus. Okay, so the site, this area has been a site of settlement for over 3,000 years. And it began as a Trachian fishing village called Lygos, and then became Byzantium in 667 BC to Constantinople, which was the capital of the Eastern Roman Empire, to the fall in 1453, the fall of Constantinople, and then the next incarnation as Istanbul, which became the capital of the Ottoman Empire. So Istanbul is located at a crucial junction of where...
Upper town.
Yeah, it's not working.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Oh, there. Where Europe, in red, meets... Now it's going automatically. Hold on a second.
Oh, no, it's doing the same thing again.
Okay, so where Europe meets... That's Europe, the whole side, meets Asia. Millions of people cross the Bosphorus every day to commute to work in both directions. And here we're in Europe looking over towards Asia. The metropolitan Istanbul population in 2021 was recorded at 15.5 million people. So nearly 19% of the entire country's population lives in metropolitan Istanbul. It's weird. That's not working. This is. Okay. Hold on. These keep jumping forward. We're just trying to, they're having computer issues here. Okay. And similar to Rome, the city's located on seven hills, so that there's always really interesting topography in the city with fantastic views through these narrow streets. And the hilltops are all capped with monumental religious buildings. So even the way people move along the streets of the crowded streets are like a fluid moving through the street or the river. Okay, that doesn't work. This does. Yes. Okay. Here, keeps jumping forward to being automatically moving forward. I'm just trying to get it back. Okay. okay, here we're looking at out at the meeting of the Marmara Sea, the Bosphorus, and the Golden Horn. So this is on the European side, from an old view and a more modern view. The old and new coexist, and when you go there, you can experience the breadth of time and cultures that have resided in this place. Here, we're looking out the wind towards the Marmara Sea. And this is the ships waiting, kind of like a parking. The Marmara is kind of like a parking lot where they're waiting in queue to go up the Bosphorus, so that they can head to the ports on the Black Sea in Eastern Europe, Russia, and Ukraine. Over the Bosphorus, there are three large suspension bridges, so cars can go back and forth between the East and West. And the Bosphorus is filled with all manner of boats, tankers, and thriving life. From large fishing operations or larger fishing operations to smaller ones, one guy. where the shores form an abundance of activity that support life along the water, including recreational fishing. And here is the Galata Bridge, the more modern Galata Bridge. And you can see it's lined with fishermen on top, and below are fish restaurants. And there are only very few days a year where it snows, and then it usually melts within a few days or hours. But this doesn't seem to stop the fishermen. Here they are in the snow. One of the best and most enjoyable ways to get from Europe to Asia or vice versa is by ferry boat. And here we can see the big one in the center of the image is a car ferry. So you can drive across the bridge or you can take a ferry with your car. And then there are pedestrian boats, such as this one. And during the various 20 to 25 minute crossings, depending on which port you're going to, but there's lots of different ways you can go, you can buy tea, a hot tea or snacks on the boat. So it's very civilized. And here you'll find everybody riding on the ferries, including village, village life is on the ferries. The city also has a newer, more bustling and vibrant sections to it, which include fashion districts, modern urban centers. This is Maslak, the financial district, the office towers, you know, global architecture, malls, towering apartment buildings. The city is continually under construction, reconstruction, and renovation and restoration. But you can also find the quiet, bucolic past of the yellas or the waterfront mansions that line the Bosphorus. And these are built as second or summer homes for the wealthy, were built for the wealthy during the Ottoman Empire. And on hot summer days, this scene can be found in many places along the Bosphorus or the Marmara Sea, where the city comes and meets the water. And then there are major monuments. This is Hagia Sophia. In the Renaissance, this building was already 1,000 years old. It was built in 537, and it was the largest Christian church in the Eastern Roman Empire. After the fall of Constantinople in 1453, it became a mosque. And with Ataturk's new Turkish Republic in 1935, it became a museum. Only to be converted in 2020, last year, back into a mosque by today's president, Erdogan. This is the Kora Church, a medieval Byzantine Greek Orthodox church, which also became a museum, and then also in 2020 was converted back into a mosque. The interior is filled with some of the world's finest Byzantine Christian mosaics and frescoes. And then there are the mosques. This is a view of the Blue Mosque looking from the rooftop of Hagia Sophia. The Blue Mosque is one of the city's larger mosques, whose location, the mosque's locations are generally take advantage of the city's topography so that the azan or call to prayer could be heard far and wide. Today, the azan is amplified through speakers, but when these buildings were built, the muezzin would climb these towers to the balconies and do the call to prayer from the balconies. And because these are Sunni Muslims, there are 5 calls a day heard throughout the city. This mosque, this is the same mosque in a snowstorm. It's the Yeni Jami. Entrances to many of the mosques from the surrounding neighborhoods go up a set of stairs like this through a covered walkway and into a forecourt to the mosque. And this is generally where you'll find the, where you do the ablutions, and then you have to remove your shoes before stepping into the quiet, open, carpeted dome spaces. And where the bustling and noisy city all of a sudden fade away. When we would go on walks through the city, we'd often look for a mosque just to have a break because the city was so dense and so much is happening all the time. Inside the mosques, you find beautiful carved marble minbars or a Muslim pulpit. Natural light filters in through these spaces, into these spaces, creating a peaceful and sacred atmosphere for worshipers and visitors. The ceiling paintings and the marble mukarnas, or a combination of carved and painted surfaces and screens, and the glazed tiles are all unique features of the mosque interiors. Surrounding each mosque is also a whole complex of buildings that support a neighborhood. And these include things like madrasas or religious schools, libraries, hospitals, schools, baths, soup kitchens, and shops. And they also include adjoining cemeteries, where vertical tombstones are capped with the headwear which indicated a person's status or profession or guild during their lifetime. And throughout the city are several hundred open and covered cisterns. Aqueducts would bring water to the storage spaces inside the walls of the city. These were built to provide water to the city and also allowed them, the city, to survive prolonged sieges. A number of open cisterns have become soccer fields today, but this is the covered is a covered 6th century basilica or Yerbatan cistern. Sits very close to Hagia Sophia and well below the bustling city above it. And from above, you would never know this even exists unless you find the little door that heads into it. And this particular one is a famous one. It's been renovated now for tourists to visit it, but it's appeared in many movies, including the 1963 James Bond film From Russia with Love. And then there's Topkapi Palace on the Seraglio Point. It's constructed in 1459 by Mehmet the Conqueror, and it served as a main residence for the Ottoman sultans. It was walled in, this is just a model of it. It's walled in and has four main courtyards, which include the large gardens that surround the smaller central piece and the stables. And then the second courtyard had the janissaries or the Sultan's military quarters were located there. And then the palace, as you go into that central piece, you enter into the palace parts. And the palace had a hospital, kitchens, libraries, and the divan, which was the seat of government for the empire. And it was like a small walled-in city inside the larger city of Istanbul or Constantinople. It was included, it also included the harem. This is a photograph of a section of the harem. The harem was where the Sultan's mother, wives, and children lived, and there were some 400 rooms in this section of the building. And this is where we're looking at is actually where the Sultan's favorites lived, because all of these windows look out onto a beautiful park to the left of the image. A garden. It's a park now. other rooms like this were where for the Sultan and his entourage, and these were where he ruled the country from, and also where he would meet foreign dignitaries. Now the roof designs are pretty interesting. They are derived from the nomadic Ottoman tents structures, and it's possible, you can see these like really fancy decorative things. They were, you can see examples of the original tents, which are set up actually in the military museum. And today, Topkapi Palace is a museum, and a World Heritage Site. There. Tents and the fluid life on the street live on in the city in the weekly market structures, which are set up each week in a specific neighborhood. These tents are only up for one day. So they come in early in the morning and then they set up everything, including all of the food and everything. First the tents, then the electric wires to provide light, because it goes all day long until late, till around 9 o'clock in the evening when they start shutting down. And this is so great. We just loved going to the markets. I mean, it was just so much better than going to a grocery store. So, okay, and this is a little video. I'm gonna just... It just gives you a little taste. So in these markets, you can buy clothing, children's toys, kitchen supplies, and food. And they're dense, filled with local produce from farmers, local farmers, small villages. Here's a stack of eggs from Chatalaja Koi, which is a town. And here it is in the evening with the lights strung along. So all of this goes up for one day and then it's taken down at the end of the day, and that group of people who are selling move to a different neighborhood and set up again the next day. So they do that 7 days, I think 7 days a week. And display culture is super important here. It actually begins here in the markets. So you can see there, it's kind of hard to see, but if you look, there's a Turkish tea glass that's filled with blood orange juice, and it's sealed on the end with a blood orange and then turned upside down as a display. Potatoes, bras. It's so much work. These people work so hard. It's so much work setting this up all day long, then selling all day. No cars go through the area where the market is set up. It's just pedestrian during the market day. And then it goes back to being a normal street. And this is the last one. I'm going to hand it over to Mark here, but just to comment that here, for some reason in Turkey, mannequins are either ignored or paid very special attention to. And Mark has for years been photographing the mannequins of Istanbul, which I think he's going to show you some pictures of that. So I'll hand it over now to Mark.
So I'm going to take you on a tour, pretty much concentrate on a particular neighborhood. This is not This is not one of the 797 separately named neighborhoods of Istanbul. I counted them. There's nearly 800 separate neighborhoods. This is a neighborhood of my own devising that I'll call Hanland, which is here. It straddles the Golden Horn. And I'll get around to the Hans shortly. But this, we can take a tour through here. We'll start here. See that gigantic structure right there? That is the Grand Bazaar, which variously is reported to have either 4,000 or 5,000 individual shops in it. This was built shortly after the Ottoman conquest of the city. I read on Wikipedia, there's 91 million annual visitors. This is the world's most visited tourist site. There's one shot inside, but we're gonna leave the Grand Bazaar and walk on the streets that go from the Grand Bazaar now down to the Golden Horn, because these streets are really extraordinary. It's full of shopping of all sorts. And like, it's crowded on shopping days. I don't know what it's like now in the time of COVID, but this was normal. And here's a little taste for you. The people on the left there are waiting for a special coffee store. They're all lined up for this Turkish coffee store. Here's the hardware district. Like many parts of the world, the commercial activity and the sales are zoned into they're sort of self-organized into their own little zones. So all the hardware sellers are in the same place, and all the people who sell shoes are in the same place. And okay, now, just indulge me a little with the mannequins of Istanbul, which to my way of thinking is it's a great collective surrealist artwork. and I'm baffled, absolutely baffled by these things. Seriously? So like, okay, the Sharpie comes into play as a kind of folk art. I have no idea what they're doing here. I have a clue what the idea behind this one is. There they are. Sometimes they're so creepy because the mannequins are just really old and they don't want to, they don't want to buy a new one. But that's a new mannequin. Like, what is that? Right. Okay, and then briefly, while we're on the streets, we have to just mention the dogs of Istanbul. I don't have photographs of the cats. There's lots of cats in Istanbul, but there's also the dogs of Istanbul, quite famous. I mean, for centuries, they've been roaming the streets of Istanbul. It's now illegal to kill or capture these dogs. So there's a whole civic and municipal infrastructure to feed the dogs and spay the dogs.
And they live on the street.
They live in the street. They're well taken care of. And they just live on, they're just part of the city. This is a hardware store on a Sunday, closed up. And there it is, open. Nice, eh? Just like that. And here we are walking through the small streets in this neighborhood I'm calling Hanland. which is, this is a metal supply place on the left. Careful, watch your step. Here's a barbershop with a classical Roman capital sort of somehow there. Here's the marine supply zone. And this is down by the Golden Horn. Refreshments are available just from these guys on the street. And now we're in a shoe district. It's so, everyone's selling the same shoes, basically. There'll be like 20, 30 shops, 40, 50, 60 shops all selling the same shoes. Women's clothing. Now, I always wanted to buy this fake money, but was a little nervous about what would happen if they opened up my bags at customs. I'm sure it's, but anyway, you can buy fake money along with your kids' toys. So all of the stuff that goes into these commercial operations for sale or raw materials going in arrive in trucks, and then on these little narrow streets. And then the goods are distributed by these porters. There's a whole kind of union, I could say, of porters that then distribute these goods onto these little narrow streets that are too small for trucks to go in. So this is a common scene in this neighborhood that I'm describing. And here we see a sign for the Kuzul Khan. So Khan, to get back to the Hanland thing, a Han is a commercial building, a Turkish, traditional Turkish commercial building. And they have these fantastic spaces in them. The model of the Han, or architectural model, is the caravanserai, which is a courtyard building. And these caravanserais were built one day's journey apart on the Silk Road and other trade routes from ancient times. And then when they got to the cities, the traders would go into a caravanserai, which is really a fixed Han, is a kind of a center of trade in the cities, but also centers of manufacturing. And this is the Rustem Pasha Han. This is built in 1550, and it's still in operation. All of these old Hans are still in operation, and they're still commercial buildings. This is in the courtyard of the Rustem Pasha Han. This is the water supply for the Han. And this is in a city of 15 million, remember. Here's the Çağlar Han. This is what was built in 1720. And here the courtyard has been filled in with lots of little stores. These are jewelry stores that are selling the jewelry that's made in the little shops that line the upper story of the Han. The two gold foundries in the two opposite corners of this Han, one is an Armenian gold foundry and the other is the Turkish gold foundry. Here's a modern Han. So this is a quite modern, I don't know, this is like an electronics Han. The Hans are divided up into separate kinds of Han. So you have the goldsmith's Han. The modern Hans would be a whole huge building. It's just cell phones. There may be multiple cell phone Hans or medical supply Hans or, you know, plastics, electrical lighting, and all of that. They're all self-organizing into. And so the modern Hans still have a kind of courtyard. There's always an open space. There's a stair and an open space. The older Hans were equipped with, a little restaurant and a mosque and everything that the workers would need in the Han to spend their day. Sometimes that's also true of these newer Hans. But the old ones are the most fascinating to me. And so here's the Serpuş Han, which is from 1735. That's on the left. Now that's the door to the Han. And most tourists, I think, coming to Istanbul would not dare walk through that door. But if you go to Istanbul, that's exactly the door that you should walk through. Not just this one, but like all the doors of all these Hans that look like you shouldn't go, you should go. And you know, our sense of public and private is quite different from the Turkish public and private, especially in the old city. Here's another nondescript doorway, and this is to the Ticaret Han. And we're gonna go inside this Han together. That's the hallway going in. And when you reach the end of the hallway, what you find is that. So all the little spaces that line this courtyard are filled with, this is mostly machinists. This is like machining parts and gasket makers, and that's what's in this Han. So this is the hallway. You go up the stairs and walk down this hallway. This was built in 1881, this Han. And here we can peek into these little workshops where the artisans, and these are machinists in this case, are busy making, machine parts. And preparing this lecture on this, here's an like a silversmith or something. Look at this silver bowl. So there's still the handcraft is still done in these Hans at a very, very high level to this day. Now I'm going to escape from this.
Mark, can I say something?
Yeah.
Just about the Hans, when we were there, I think I was like 13, and I was there with Nada and a group of students. And one of the things that they did with the public and private is, I mean, we just walked in to have a look around. I think they must have been making jewelry or some sort of metal something. And we just got brought into this room, and these guys were so excited and just wanted, like, the students were taking photos and videos and were so excited. And in order to like give them something to take a video or photo of or to experience something, one of the guys was like sort of getting nodded. He says, you know, give me a ring. So she takes off her wedding ring, and he goes and he shines up the whole wedding ring. So he turns on all these tools and he goes in showing how it works. And then he like, you know, he sort of hands it back. And it was, that's the sort of, again, another example of the public and private and how you just get brought in. They probably gave us tea too. I don't really remember that because that's sort of go to all the time, but
yeah, if you poke your head in there and just start trying to talk to someone, you probably end up being offered tea,
even if you don't speak the language. But anyway, Nada's wedding ring looked like a mirror by the end of it. It was incredible.
So when preparing this lecture, I found this amazing website. This is the Ticaret Han, and we can enter. Let's go in the hallway, shall we? Here. So there's the stair. That's the stairway up to the hallway. Here we are in the hallway. And I think we can probably go, yep, because we can go through this door. And now we can visit inside. We won't get tea on this particular visit. But look at these amazing spaces. So this guy, let's see, what do they make? I don't know what they make. I can't tell what they make. Oh, gaskets. Looks like they might make gaskets. Or, wow, fantastic, no? So what a trip to find the Ticaret Han, one of my favorite Hans, like online. Okay, well, yeah, we can come back here if you want to, but I just want to give you a little taste like that. Now we'll go back here and let's talk about food. Food in Turkey is spectacular. As you saw from the weekly markets, the food is always fresh food. And when you're on the streets, we're back in the same neighborhood now, there's always food available with little push carts or from small restaurants. Always fresh, always delicious. And again, this spectacular display culture that somehow goes into some twisted form with the mannequins. But okay, look at the eggs. How many eggs would you like? There's a grilled meat joint. Little corner stores, kind of dépanneur. This guy's selling chocolates. This is a cafe. It's just missing people. And that's sweet. And this is a restaurant. So there are restaurants everywhere, and they come out and take whatever is left of the sidewalk in these little narrow streets. These guys are eating at their work. This is their lunchtime. You know where your meat comes from. Comes down the streets where it comes from. Seafood restaurant. Pop out of that neighborhood briefly to look at Istiklal Jadesi, which is this main walking street. It has a 19th century French tram that runs up and down the street. But in the pre-COVID times, this would have been a Friday evening, maybe Saturday or Sunday. It's a major shopping street. Lots of, fashionable clothing shops, bookstores, and all and so forth, running up and down. This is the main spine that runs through this section of the city. And now we're just gonna, as there's just photographs of people in the city. These guys are not bums, they're just fishermen trying to stay warm. It's a big deal when it snows in Istanbul, it's a big deal. It obviously doesn't have the right tools. You might want to bring a snow shovel when you come and give it to one of these shop owners. I'm sure they.
I had my fingers crossed you'd have that photo.
Yeah. I can't tell you how important friendship is in Istanbul. It's a big deal, friendship. I mean, it is to us too, but it's you have to like crank it up to 11 or 12. For the Turks. So I don't know if they're just on a date or whether these are tourists, but there's people from all over the world coming to Istanbul. And this, there's this divide. I don't know if it's a divide, there's a difference between secular modern Turk and, well, there could be also religious modern Turks between religious Turks, secular Turks, that coexist perfectly in Istanbul, despite the politics of having an Islamist government, despite the tension that comes from that, on a normal basis at school or at work or on the streets, this dichotomy is managed in a typically Turkish way, which is to say in a fluid, and patient way. This guy insisted that I take his photograph. He was looking sharp that day, and it's recorded. Some more friends. This is a funeral. Women headed into the women's entrance of a mosque for a funeral. It's my life. And village life is alive in its own way. Many, many people in Istanbul come directly from some small Turkish village, or their parents came from some small Turkish village. Most people in Istanbul will tell you which village is actually their home village, even if they were raised in Istanbul and not in the village. So this is a shot, a little video taken outside the window of our apartment, the last apartment that we had. And so this is just to say, you know, that this is the fluidity of, we mentioned it several times, the fluidity of Istanbul is both literal and metaphoric. Between the sea air and the endless cups of tea that accompany every conversation or every negotiation. The Turks are extraordinarily adaptable. They expect turbulence and they handle it fluidly and masterfully, both individually and collectively. It is a surprisingly gentle city. It's one of the most gentle cities I know. The prime example might be the dogs, and it's against the law to kill the dogs, and they're taking care of dogs. You know, there's no honking. The cars don't honk, even when they're trapped in one of these little streets for long periods of time when the traffic is jammed up. The horns are not honking. People don't yell across the street to get anyone's attention. It's extraordinarily safe and extraordinarily civil. And it's a city of immense variety and complexity. William Gibson, the science fiction author, in one of his interviews said that he reckons there's two kinds of cities in the world. One is a city where they let you weld on the sidewalk, and the other cities you can't do that. But Istanbul is a city where you can do welding on the sidewalk. It's certainly in the old neighborhoods and in the poorer neighborhoods. And then there's the rich neighborhoods that have shopping malls that are more luxurious than anything you've ever been in, if you haven't been to that, you know, this other part of the world. There's billions of tourists, millions of tourists come every year from both East and West. So it's not just Europeans and Americans and so forth who are coming, but people from the Middle East as well. The city absorbs traders and refugees from around the world. That's traders with a D. And the absorption of the refugees is at a scale that's unimaginable to us in North America. For example, that 3.6 million Syrian refugees now live in Turkey, in a country of like 85 million people. And they've absorbed 3.6 million refugees just from Syria alone.
Great restaurants.
The Syrian restaurants are spectacular.
Fabulous.
That they didn't used to have, you know, like that's one of the things that happened to the city is there are all these amazing new restaurants with Syrian cuisine. And unlike other great and ancient European cities, the architectural heritage and monuments are accessible. They're not museum pieces roped off. I mean, you can touch them, walk in them. They're still working and living. It's not old history. It's a living history. It's a living body of the city. Now, the old Hans are a really good example of that. Now, we have not mentioned the great museums. We haven't really gone into the numerous Byzantine monuments and masterpieces that are there from the times of Constantinople. We haven't talked about the existing city walls, the same city walls that were breached in 1453. They're still there. Roman aqueducts are still there. There are islands without cars where horses and carriages are the main means of transport. That's also part of the city. There's great music, innumerable little clubs and cafes and stuff where music is played on the weekends and at night. Turkish pop music is great. It's one of their major cultural exports. There's small villages up the Bosphorus that it's really like going to a village, even though it's, you know, connected to the mass transit system of bus system and so forth. And we could go on and on and on. I mean, this is a little slice, but it's our slice in our half hour, and that's it. So I don't know if you have questions or anything else, but we're here for that.
And I'll just say that when most people go to travel there, they'll go for 3 days. That's the kind of normal amount of time, which in 3 days you would see so little. I mean, it's really, if you can go there and you can afford to, and actually right now, because there's large inflation in Turkey, it's very cheap for us to go there. Even when it isn't, when there isn't inflation there, it's still a very inexpensive place to travel. It's really worth trying to go for as long as possible. Because, yeah, like we said, we haven't even scratched the surface of what we could show about the city. It's just an amazing place. It's our favorite, all-time favorite city.
Cool. That's incredible. I have so many questions. Do people have questions? If you want it, we can all just sort of like unmute maybe and just go for it.
Okay. Let's get rid of the screen share.
My question is, like, how do people know where to go to get stuff? Does everybody know which Han sells what they need, and then how do you pick? I mean, are there telephone books, or is everybody on the internet, or does everybody just know?
Well, they had phones before we did. Like, I remember going there, everybody had cell phones.
Well, they had cell phones.
And I'm like, oh my God, everyone has their own phone. So they're more advanced that way, but they're a phone book? Like, is there a phone
book? No, we would just ask.
Yeah.
We would just ask people, you know. It's like, I needed to get a cell phone. The last time I was there, I needed to get a cell phone. And I was like, where do I go to get a cell phone? You know? And they said, oh yeah, there's a cell phone Han down in Sirkeci, this other neighborhood. And sure enough, I walked into a Han, there's like kind of courtyard thing with like a stair, and the whole, I don't know, it's probably four, it's a modern Han, it's four or five stories. Mm. It must've been 200 shops dealing in cell phones. Some were cracking the cell phones, some were selling them, some were repairing them, you know.
And then how do you pick where to get your cell phone?
You just walk in and you know, you say like, what do you have for cell phones? Or you just start. And if they don't have what you want, they'll either send you, or sometimes they'll walk to their friend who's selling the thing that you want.
Or tell you to wait and go and get it and bring it back for you.
Yes, that's right. Or they send a boy to run through the streets to come back with the thing that you want.
And
somewhere else that you don't know where it's coming from.
And in the meantime, they'll offer you some tea while you wait.
Sure.
I was going to say that.
But you said there's no yelling. So they're not competing with each other. They're not yelling in the streets.
They're yelling in the markets about what they're selling and the price they're selling
and
things
good
for.
How good their
but they will
is.
Never yell at a person. If they're trying to get someone's attention, they'll cross the street and go and catch them. They will never yell to someone. And we noticed that because Mark yells a lot.
Because I grew up in New York City. That's how you get a hold of someone. Someone's like across the street.
And he would, like, whatever. Yesh and I would be on the other side and he'd go, yo, you know, calling us. And just everybody would turn and look and think,
what's wrong?
We're like, oh, okay, we shouldn't have done that.
Less yelling like we would think about it, and more like a refrain that's chanted loudly over and over and over and over again.
Yeah, in the markets.
In the markets.
In
like
the street markets.
That loud yelling on the streets is more like that than what we would associate as like yelling to get people to come into a business.
There was something in chat from Pearl. Did the movie we told you about that takes place in Istanbul, Paper Lives, feel real to you?
Oh, so the Paper Lives, I started watching that movie and then I stopped because it was a Hollywood, it was modeled after a Hollywood movie. And it was actually, I saw things in that movie that don't happen in Turkey. And it was amped up. It was just amped up. The drama and the violence and the danger in the streets and everything was kind of ramped up to a level that was implausible to me. And so I said, this is like.
Because I remember about 20 years ago going to visit Leningrad with Randy and Anne, and the Oliver Twist component of that movie, the kind of running around of these band of kids, it definitely was there in Leningrad. I was curious to know if you'll, I guess not in Istanbul really, eh?
I think an interesting film that gives you, I think, a more accurate picture of the underbelly of street life in Istanbul is a movie that's out now, which is about the dogs of Istanbul. What's it called?
The dogs of Istanbul.
No, I don't think so. No, it's not called The Dogs of Istanbul.
It's a really good film. And it's much more real.
It's a documentary. Yeah.
It's not a fiction
being. And you can, I mean, there's Syrian street kids living on the street with the dogs in the film. And it's all, I mean, it's a documentary. It's all, that's who they are. They're not playing a part, like in a Hollywood style movie. And you can see how they're treated so gently.
Yeah.
Everyone, they're treated gently. The dogs are treated gently. And that's like, this is Turkey. This is actually Turkey.
And that's what we sense a little bit more in the movie that Nicola Reeves was involved in on the homeless of the 21st century. They really spent about 15 minutes looking at these shanty towns. And it was interesting to see these architectural students trying to find the kind of local cultural indicators inside these shanty towns, and came back with a series of rules that probably have the same richness that go back to the 6th century, a series of proportions of spaces, how the light comes in, the materiality, the scale of it as well.
Rebecca says the film is called Stray.
Stray, that's it.
Subtitle, Dogs of Istanbul.
It's actually made by a woman, I think, who lives in Los Angeles.
She's got the link. The link is up in chat. If you guys open the chat.
Spent like 4 years making the movie.
Yeah, four years following.
Review in the Guardian of the film. That, I mean, these guys told us about it. I just looked it up while you were talking.
Yeah. And the gentleness of the city comes through in that film, even though it's dealing with like the scroungiest, lowest of the poorest of the poor.
What do you suppose that is? Why are they so gentle when they are like living on top of each other? And a lot of people look like they don't have that much money. I could be wrong. Why? And then there's America.
I think it has maybe a lot to do with the fact that most of those people come from villages. So the pace and patience and gentleness of village life is somehow alive in this city of 15 million. But it's also maybe, I don't know, it's also the Turks. It's also the Turks. The Turks are.
But I would just add that, you know, on a few occasions we've seen men scuffling and fighting, and I swear to God, if that ever happens, they're ready to kill each other.
Yeah.
I mean, it is not gentle at all. It's complete all the way. There's no joking if they start getting into a fight.
But they don't fight. They don't fight. That's the thing. Yeah, but like I'm in a North American city or something, there'd be like bar fights or men pushing each other, like trying to see how far it goes and throwing punches. None of that happens. If two men in Turkey fight, one of them will kill the other one. Mm-hmm. But they're slow. It takes a lot to get to that level, and they don't fight until that moment. And then when they do fight, you see other people come in and pull them apart, because nothing's ever done alone in Turkey. Hardly ever anything's done alone. There's always a web of connections to other people, which is what the tea is all about. And it's what the negotiating is all about. It's what the Hans are all about. It's why all the shoe sellers are in the same place.
Everything's negotiated there. It's a
and renegotiated.
Life is a kind of negotiation. And it's strange for a lot of tourists when they go to the market, they don't negotiate for anything. Mm-hmm. But if you do, you get into a whole nother level of understanding of the culture, that it's not just about getting a better price. It's about actually being actively participating in the culture itself. So if you don't bargain at all and you just pay and then you walk like you would in North America, you're living like you're in North America. You're not living like you're in Turkey. And so it's everything's a negotiation there, everything. Even how you walk on the street. So this whole thing that we said is like the city's full of fluids. Well, it's surrounded by fluids, but when you walk in the street, we had to learn how to walk in the street when we first got there. I remember, like, you know, we'd bump into things and now you can walk and you know exactly how to move to stay in a kind of fluid motion. Mm. So it's a very much a part of what that place is all about.
Could you guys talk about how, because you've been going there for so long, could you talk about what you think has changed since when you first started going? Ooh. If anything, security.
Yeah. One thing that is really a drastic change from the early years till like the more recent years is that there used to be with tapes and DVD and CDs. They used to be little carts all over the place blasting out Turkish pop music.
Selling music.
So you would hear music everywhere. Now you don't hear music anywhere because people are either plugged in or, you know, things like that. So the absence of music is really striking to me as one of the big changes that happened from when we started going there till more recent years.
Yeah, people used to sell music on, like music bazaars. Selling music on the street, that's true.
You know, a lot of them were copies, like illegal copies and stuff, but there was just, it was present in the air when you would walk around the city, and now it's not.
There's a subtle change where the Erdogan has been building more and more mosques and maybe even placing them strategically, like on a chessboard, so that it's harder to find your drinks in some neighborhoods because certain radius around a mosque, you can't sell alcohol.
Mm. So,
I used to live very close to one. And what happened was that the little, sort of like a depanneur, a corner store, used to sell beer. And I would get my beer there. And then it closed down. The guy just completely shut the whole thing down because Erdogan said, okay, now you cannot sell beer. You cannot sell any alcohol within this radius.
But I remember, Nada, you said that when you taught, you can tell the difference of his influence on the students. But as a tourist, could we really see the difference?
I would say no.
No. Well, in the early years that we went there, he had just gotten in. And there was like, you know, our secular friends were actually supportive of him at that time. Because it was just booming in Turkey at that time. And now the same people, I just like hate the guy. And you know, part of the reason why we left and came back was the big referendum that happened there in 2018, where he just decided to make himself president with all these extra powers. And it's just, the night that happened, I was in my apartment and I leaned out the window. I could hear this noise outside. I leaned out the window and everybody in the whole neighborhood was leaning out their window, banging their pots and pans with each other because basically in Istanbul is more liberal and the changes he wanted to make were not voted in Istanbul, but they were in other places. So, and especially in places like Germany with the Turks in Germany, where a large portion, they were allowed to vote from Germany. Mm. And they're huge supporters of Erdogan. So I just, you know, every time I would go in to work, my colleagues were just getting more and more depressed. And I just like, it was so hard to stay there, to work, just to see things getting worse and worse and worse under Erdogan.
But can I say also that every time that we've gone there from before Erdogan and now after Erdogan, there's always a political crisis.
Yeah.
It's like steady state. There's always some crisis.
Coups.
It's like everything, you know, the PKK shooting up places, and it's always a crisis. Mm-hmm. Corruption, the government corruption. So this normal, this like normal is normal. So the Turks are also sort of nonplussed about the whole thing. It's like, okay, well, now it's this and now it's that. So they're quite used to living in chaos. Mm-hmm. And they just go like that. Just keep going like this.
Do you think that the further Islamicization that Erdogan is sliding in has a direct effect on women's lives? Like, have you noticed, like I was thinking about, you know, if there are young Muslim women whose families are Muslim, but then at night they would like go out to a nightclub, and this fluidity of these different identities, I think, you know, was that possible in an earlier time? But now that things are becoming much more strict, do women, particularly young women, feel like they have to somehow comply?
You might have to ask some young Turkish women in Istanbul about that.
Well, I mean, I had students, many of them, who were women, but no, I don't think they live you know, it's very different there than it is in North America. And even you just, for us, we could just look at who was teaching in the universities. In Canada, it's like a very small proportion are women teaching in architecture schools. And in Turkey, it's at least 60%.
And the dean is women, a woman, probably.
And it was like not done to get the numbers up, like it's done in North America. It's just, so it's very different. It's a very different set of attitudes. Mm-hmm. And so I never felt, and nor did I ever hear from my female students that they were shackled in any way in their public life.
It's not Saudi Arabia.
It's absolutely not. They have a lot of power, women, actually, there, especially the mother is like the head of the house. In many, many, in most houses, I would say the mother, many of our friends have said that to us, how important the mother is.
There are women, there's a whole network of informal public transit in these little minibuses. They're called dolmish. Dolmish means stuffed. So like they fill up and then they run a little route. They run a route. So all these routes, that you have to know which route to take. And we used to commute on a dolmish to the university, and we had to find our seats strategically so that the ablas, the older sister, the older ladies, when they get on the bus, they will sit where they want to, and they expect you to get up and give them a seat.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's something like getting bullied by ladies on the bus. So there's a different, you know, it's got its own dynamic about that. And I'm not saying it's not a misogynist culture, but it's complicated. Mm-hmm. And it's definitely not Saudi Arabia.
We noticed when we were spending time a couple of years ago in Ahmedabad in India, that this kind of new and old were so Jekyll and Hyde. There was almost no transition between the two. Mm. It's like you hit a wall on a street and it went from one to the other. Mm. Is that a similar feeling, or is there kind of a blend of the new and the old mixing together?
I'd say a blend.
In certain places it's a blend, and then there's other places where it's just only modern stuff, or other places where everything's just falling apart. I mean, it really, it's everything and it's everything in between. It's both and everything in between.
But there's no dissonance. I mean, I don't sense, as an outsider, I don't sense any dissonance between the old and the new, for example.
Mark, just a thing that from Rebecca's question about that, like one of the things that wasn't in the photos of people is like the sort of groups of friends that you see out on the street, where there can be, you know, maybe two or three different styles of hijab. You'll see group of friends, which sort of indicates
different either levels of how religious they are, or and then also like just girls that have their hair either cut short or dyed crazy colors, and it's all, they're all one group of friends, and there's no real distinction between them that you can see.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You might expect to see.
There's not judgment. Right. There's no judgment of one the secular group towards the religious or the religious. I mean, they kind of let them let your friends be.
Yep. Nice. A kind of tolerance there.
Yeah. Incredibly tolerant. Yeah. The Turks are incredibly tolerant.
Yeah.
This is a non-political question. It's the opposite end of the spectrum. Do a lot of Istanbulians, or whatever one calls the city dwellers, have like little escapes out in the country? Do people go to dashas? Do they have little, you know, cottages, or what's the equivalent of our cottage country in Canada?
The wealthy ones do.
Okay, only the wealthy ones. All right.
Well, the really wealthy are the ones up and down the Bosphorus, but then you know there is within like an hour to 2 hours drive outside, there's all kinds of kind of little communities that are built up with buildings that house multiple families. And those are kind of, we have friends who's a guy who's an architect, and his family and his brothers and his cousins would all gather and just hang out and have barbecues and stuff like that. But it's not like, for example, in Canada, to go to a cottage is to get away from everything into the wilderness and to be in nature and to not be around people. Well, there it's to get together. So it's all about not being alone. Like, they don't do things alone. They love doing things together. So I can imagine that this pandemic has hit that country so hard, because it's really, really
baked into the culture.
They do everything together.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
They sell shoes together.
Yeah, everything.
Wow, this is amazing. We are actually, you know, at a quarter after 4 o'clock. We can keep going. Are there any more questions? Mark and Nada, this has been incredible. I almost want to go to Istanbul. Not quite, but almost.
We'll take you.
Yeah, come with us.
I am alone. I and especially after this island, I'm like, I can't deal with crowds anymore.
Oh, it might freak you out a little bit.
I don't know how you guys go from Istanbul to Spruland, but.
Well, we both love city life also, but we have to also get away from it. So being alone on Spruce Island for months at a time is great. But then being dropped down like a helicopter into a city is also great. It's so invigorating. So for us, we like both ends on the spectrum.
Yes. Well, when we can travel, it would be amazing to go with you and see. Well, thank you very much. This is amazing. Thanks all for coming. And it has been recorded, and you can see it again or tell people about it. It's on our website, alplibrary.org. And so I'm going to say, Claire said she wanted to visit you in Istanbul one day. Hey, Claire.
Absolutely.
Let's set the date.
Ooh, pick a date. Excellent. Well, thank you all, everybody.